started this channel in middle school service, and we hope it will help middle school service, church, and all of our community as well. We are so happy and blessed to be talking with our beloved bishop as our first guest on our new channel. We just started this channel to put the light on our talented kids, and it is also an invitation for other kids and servants in our community to join us and find out about their talents. The goal of this program is to know more about our beloved fathers and to learn from their knowledge and experience. In the next few minutes, we will ask you some spiritual and personal questions to know more about you.
I'm traveling. I travel always between churches and monasteries, so my daily routine differs, depends on where I am. For example, if I'm in the monastery, my day starts with my praises and liturgy. Then I go to my cell and I start appointment with the monks or the nuns. Then I have some personal time to myself, time to do like my office work, emails, phone calls, time to prepare like sermons or lectures. Then in the evening, we have evening prayer with all the monks or the nuns, and then again some appointments till the end of the day. That's my daily routine in the monastery. In the church, when I visit the church, in the weekend, usually we have liturgy and vespers, and in between like appointments. But on the weekdays, I keep the morning most of the time to myself for my personal life, for reading, for office work, etc. And in the evening, we go and do visitations or appointments or meetings in the church. But if there's activity in the morning, like visiting some people in the hospital or liturgies, so it's flexible. So I don't have a daily routine because I travel from place to place. So my schedule actually differs, depends on the church or the monastery or the community that I'm visiting.
How do you spend your free time?
I don't have free time. I am behind. If you give me 2 years to finish things that I'm behind, it will not be enough. So I don't have free time. Every day, from the moment I wake up until I sleep, I'm working. And I have sleep deprivation, if you understand what this means. And I don't sleep enough hours. So I don't have free time. You know, when we have convention or conference, usually in the schedule there is time called free time. This free time is the time of my appointments. So people want to meet with me, that's my free time. So all my time are free, but I enjoy what I'm doing, I'm not complaining. So I don't need that, I don't feel that I need free time because meeting with the people, when God gives me to help the people, it gives me the relaxation that anybody gets when he has free time.
Sayin, it is your first time for you to visit San Mark after the remodeling. How do you like it?
Oh, I am very, very, very happy with it. It's beautiful church. I couldn't believe it is the same church. Everything is beautiful. The iconostasis, the altar, the icons all over, the painting, the choice of the lights, the pews, the woodwork. Everything is really, really beautiful. I like it very much.
So, you know, some kids say they do not have any talents. What advice can you give them?
I don't believe that anybody has no talents, because God gave each one of us at least one time. But maybe some people, when they say, I don't have talent, means they mean I don't have a prominent talent, like a musician, or I have a beautiful voice so I can sing, or I am very, very expert in IT, something like this. But if you read about the gifts of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, one of the gifts is called chapter 12, sorry, chapter 12. One of the gifts called helps. No. So to help others is a talent. So just to help others, for example, if I find somebody needs a cup of water and I take this cup of water and give it to him, that's a talent, to have a compassionate heart. So I need actually to pray and ask God to help me to discover my talent. Then when I listen to the feedback from others, you know, for example, somebody will be say, Yidna, you are good in helping others. Maybe that's my talent. Or say, Yidna, you are good in listening. So maybe my talent now is just to listen and give this comfort to the people. Say, Yidna, you're good, for example, in organizing convention. Maybe that's my talent, administration. So everybody has talent, even if it is not prominent, but God distributed the gift to each one as He wills.
Some kids say that our liturgy service is very long. That's why they use their phones during liturgy. What advice do you have about that?
So, what is reasonable for saying how many hours?
I guess anything more than an hour, kids get tired of, in my opinion.
More than 1 hour?
I guess. Okay.
But if we say 1 hour, some people may say, it's long, why it's not 30 minutes?
I guess it's different for everyone.
You know, that's what happened in other churches. For example, in the Catholic Church, the Mass is 30 minutes. You know, and there are some churches, I'm not joking here, I'm serious, some churches in Texas are drive-through churches. See your expression of faith. So, when we come to the church, we come to spend time with God. And if we really, really love God, we will not feel that the church is long. Why we feel the church is long? Because we come in our mind when they will finish, I want to leave. So from the moment I enter the church, I want to leave. But people actually who come to enjoy spending time with God, they will not feel it long. For example, if there is a friend, you are going to visit this friend, but you don't want to spend the time. So from the first moment you went to visit this friend, you want actually to spend the shortest time to leave because you don't feel comfortable around him. You know. Even if you spend 20 minutes, you're going to say, oh, finally I left. It's been 20 minutes. But if you love somebody, maybe you can spend half day, 6 hours, 9 hours, and you will not feel bored. Same way, people who like sports, I can watch the Super Bowl or whatever for hours, and I don't feel it's too long. But if I don't like sports, 15 minutes, it will be too long. 10 minutes will be too long because, you know, I don't like sports. And so on. For example, yesterday, many deacons attended with us from 3, we started at 3, and we finished at 12. 9 hours, you know. But most of us, because we were enjoying praising God and enjoying the time, we don't feel the 9 hours. It just went just like that. But if we think from the first moment, oh, it's 3, I want to leave. No, I will be
frustrated from the first 20 minutes. You understand what I'm saying?
Living here in the U.S., many kids say that they should be more Americanized than Coptic. What are your thoughts about that?
What do you mean by Americanized? Language or culture or tradition or?
All of them.
Language, yes. That's why most of our liturgy are now English. For example, liturgy today, most of it was in English. Yesterday in midnight praises, we have Coptic or Arabic and have English. People have the right to enjoy and to pray in language they understand. But also we understand that our culture is Coptic, especially for us who are Coptic, not convert, not American, join the church. So it's part of our identity, part of who we are. And I know one of the programs for the middle school is about learning Coptic. Let's learn Coptic. This will connect you with our heritage. And this is very important. Let me share a story with you. I visited Spain about 7 years ago, and I met a Catholic monk. So he gave me a book. He translated to Spanish by Saint Pacom, the father of Quirin. But I personally, I don't read or understand Spanish. So I asked him, can you tell me the name of the book in English? Assuming that he translated the book from English to Spanish. So he told me the English version is not nobody translated to English, it does not exist. So I asked him, then from which language you translated the book? He told me I translated from Coptic, and he is not Egyptian, he's from Spain. So I asked him, from Coptic, do you know Coptic? He told me I studied Coptic for 7 years until I mastered the language. Reading, writing, speaking, and translating. I told him, why you are doing this? He told me, because there are treasures written in the Coptic language, and nobody translated, and I want to translate it to our language, to Spanish language. To tell you the truth, I felt embarrassed that some person who's not Coptic spent 7 years in mastering the Coptic language in order to translate our heritage that's written in Coptic, to the Spanish language. So, yes, we need to pray in the language, we understand, but in the same way, we should not forget our heritage. Speaking about the converts, it's a different story. People who are American, but join the Coptic Church. That's a different story. We need actually to serve them in the language they understand. That's why we started to establish the American Coptic Orthodox Churches, like Sandrina American Coptic Orthodox Church here in Nashville. In the ceremony, in the culture, for us we need to integrate both cultures. The American culture and the Coptic culture, to integrate them together. Integrate means take the best of the two cultures and integrate them together. But again, speaking about the American convert, they have the right to have their own culture. Culture here, I'm speaking about food. For example, we speak Arabic and Syrians speak Arabic also. So if I attended a liturgy with the Syrian Orthodox Church, I will understand because they speak in Arabic and I understand their Arabic. And then after the liturgy, we will eat together, but we eat food from Syria. It tastes very well. But at the end, I will feel liturgy. So the language I understand, and I enjoy the food, but at the end, it's not home. It's very important for a person to feel home when he comes to the church. You know? So when we say we need to incorporate the culture or make the Americans converted to Orthodoxy, when we say they feel home in the churches, then definitely culture should be important for them. But culture is not the holy tradition of the church. That's why I asked you, is language or culture or tradition? When it comes to the holy tradition of the church, and tradition with capital T, our rites, our doctrines, our dogma, our faith, we cannot compromise it. We cannot compromise because that is the foundation of who we are. So I'm differentiating between me from Celtic background and the convert who has no Celtic background. They have the right to create their own language and their own culture. But we, the integration between the two or three languages, Celtic, English, and Arabic, and also the integration between the two cultures, very important.
Some kids mistreat their parents, telling them that they can't understand them because of their Egyptian background or their language barrier. What are your thoughts about that?
This is actually a challenge when the parents don't speak the same language like their children or don't understand the culture of their children. And here my advice to the parents to educate themselves in order to be able to communicate with their children. And educate not only in the language, of course language is very important, because in the language they can communicate together, they can understand what lyrics they hear, what they read, etc. But if I don't understand the language and my children are reading bad lyrics, how can I judge? How can I say it's bad lyrics? No, you cannot listen to this song. Also, to understand the education, for example, here's a culture. If their children told them my GPA, or I have SAT exam, or if the parents don't understand this, what does this mean? How can they guide their children? And how can they help them or hold them accountable? So the children, the parents should educate themselves, and also I think it is the responsibility of our churches to raise the awareness of the people and to educate them. Either, I know many churches, they teach English, they educate the parents about the system, education system, university system, etc., in order to bridge the gap between parents and children. But it can be a really challenge if the parents and children cannot communicate together.
Okay, so now say it again. Imagine one day you open your eyes and you find yourself in the Old Testament. Which character would you like to be and why?
Saint Joseph. I like him, you know. In Egypt, in Sunday school, we used to serve, you know, every stage, we call it, for example, primary school, we call it angels. Then, second half of primary school, we call it the apostles. Third, then middle school, we call it the prophets. So when actually I was servant in middle school, I have to choose name of a saint from the Old Testament, because it's called the prophets. So I chose Saint Joseph, son of the righteous son of Jacob. You know, this man, how he lived purity, how he endured to be in prison, not to compromise his virtue, how he was strong in his relationship with God, how he served his brothers, and he put his trust in God. That's why God elevated him. So his story, usually, from my childhood, impressed me. So that's one of the characters I like from the Old Testament.
One day you open your eyes and you found yourself as Judas Iscariot after betraying Jesus Christ and before killing himself. What would you do, and what is your thought on people thinking to commit suicide?
I don't like to be like this. But I think for Judas, he did not speak with anybody. If he shared his ideas sincerely with anybody, for example, if he went to Peter or John or James or Andrew and told them, I betrayed the Lord Jesus Christ and I regret this, now there is no hope for me, there is no forgiveness, I'm going to kill myself, I'm sure they would give him a good advice. Peter would tell him, you know what, I denied the Lord Jesus Christ. But don't you remember when they brought the Lord Jesus Christ, the woman caught in sin, and how he forgave her? Don't you remember when the Lord told us you need to forgive 7 times 70? So the Lord will forgive you. They would encourage him. But the issue that he did not share, he did not expose his thoughts, and he did not share it with anybody. And one of the benefits of confession is to expose our thoughts and to disclose our bad intentions to Abuna. And then we will get a good advice that will help me to overcome the temptation of the devil. So maybe if Judas shared with somebody, his life wouldn't end this way.
As a middle schooler, how can we help our church?
Middle school are very important stage in life, because you are transitional between children, like in primary or elementary school, and young adult. And in middle school, you are like adolescent. So a lot of creativity, a lot of ideas, a lot of energy. And if these ideas, creativity, energy, thoughts, directed and discovering my talents and directed this talent toward the service of God, actually can help your church a lot. Like, for example, this channel is a very, very good idea. The interviews, the presentation, the choir, also can one day come help, for example, in cleaning the church, decorating the church, go and visit the sick. There are many, many people here. Actually, if you go visit them, giving them flower, especially like on a feast day or something like this, serving the, go to the homeless, serve them. Many, many things, especially as I said, you have a lot of energies, you have a lot of ideas, creativity. So use all of this to the glory of God.
Is there anything else you would like to share with us, Sayyidina?
I am happy that I met with the four of you and through you, all the middle school boys and girls. And I like to conclude by saying that The Bible tells us, remember your Creator in the days of your youth. What you're going to actually store in your life in these years will remain with you to the end of your life. God bless this ministry, God bless this channel, and from success to success, God willing.
At the end, we'd like to thank you for the opportunity to talk to you today. It was such a big blessing for us to know more about you. We also appreciate all the thoughts you shared with us today. Please pray for us in prayer service.
Thank you, Rodas.